This book is addressed to Hebrew people. And the reason it's addressed to Hebrew people is because there's a particular message that God has for them. We've pointed out, and I just put this chart up just to help you see it all in a nutshell. You'll notice Genesis to Malachi has to do with God's promises to the nation of Israel. Jesus Christ in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John said he's not sent but to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. He didn't go America and South America and all that. Jesus Christ came to the nation of Israel. He came to be their king. They rejected him, crucified him. He died, was buried. He rose again, even sent the Holy Spirit after he ascended into heaven to the nation of Israel to further explain how that through the cross now he can give them everything he ever promised them. They continued to reject him. What God warned is that there's going to be a judgment. He said all manner of sin and blasphemy against the Son will be forgiven. Blasphemy against the Holy Spirit will not be forgiven. There's going to be a time of judgment, and then Jesus Christ is going to come back and reign. But before that judgment ever fell, God stopped his dealings with the nation of Israel. He saved Saul of Tarsus, Paul the apostle to the Gentiles, and rather than bringing wrath into this world, God turned to us Gentiles and offered us his grace, an opportunity to be saved through the cross of Jesus Christ, because he didn't just die for Israel, he died for us. And this is the age we live in today. And so you got Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. You came into the ministry of the Holy Spirit in the book of Acts. But then God interrupts. In the middle of the book of Acts, you can see that Paul is saved and sent to the Gentiles. When you read Romans to Philemon, you find out what God is saying to us today. But Paul also told us that in our salvation, we are saved from the wrath to come. There is still a coming wrath. God might have postponed it, but it's still going to come. And when you come to this section of your Bible, after you get done with Paul's epistles, you come to Hebrews through Revelation. And Hebrews through Revelation is a warning and preparing people for a great trial that's going to come. You can read all the details of that trial in the book of Revelation. But Hebrews through Revelation prepares them for this time. And then in Revelation 19, Jesus Christ returns. Revelation chapter 20, he sets up this kingdom. And the great white throne, the lake of fire is there. Following that is the great white throne judgment. But this age was not known. And so as we consider God's ministry to the nation of Israel, it helps just to fold that a little bit. Since that wasn't known, the program for the nation of Israel is after that Holy Spirit came, there was a time of wrath coming. The book of Hebrews is talking, it's addressed to Hebrew people because of that. And the things that they have to believe is not just the cross work of Christ. The Hebrews is pointing to that cross as the hope for Israel. But it's also warning them of trial of faith that they're going to go through. And so we came to Hebrews chapter 11, and we began to go through Moses' life last time, and we did it. We finished this, but I want to go back and just read from verses 24 through 30. And then there was one thing that I promised you I'd pick up this week. That's why I'm going to go back and review it. What I want you to do is realize that as we talk about faith, when they believed what God said, it caused a response. And so just look at the verb of what their response is and think about, for those of you who know the book of Revelation, know what kind of trial of faith the nation of Israel is going to go through and the whole world's going to go through it. The time of wrath, and realize what these details are about Moses' life is not just telling you them something about Moses, but it's preparing them for what they're going to face. And so you watch the verbs. It says in verse 24, it says, by faith Moses, when he was come to years, refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter. What's the verb? Refused. Think about that word. Verse 25. Choosing, and is that choosing a verb or anyhow, choosing rather to suffer the affliction with the people of God than to enjoy the pleasures of sin for a season. Verse 26, esteeming the reproach of Christ greater riches than the treasures in Egypt, for he had respect unto the recompense of reward. By faith he forsook Egypt, not fearing the wrath of the king, for he endured as seeing him who is invisible. So what we see so far in all that's being said, he refused to be called the son of Moses, the son of Pharaoh's daughter. Refuse, some people got to refuse some things in here, don't they? A mark of the beast is going to be set up in there. Choosing rather to suffer affliction with, to suffer affliction with the people of God. Isn't that the choice here? You either take the mark of the beast and have it good, or suffer affliction with the people of God. And he was esteeming the riches of Christ, or esteeming the reproaches of Christ greater riches than the treasures of Egypt. What are you going to esteem? What this man has to offer, or what Jesus Christ is going to offer to them? And so they have to make that same decision. For he had respect unto the recompense of reward. It says, by faith he forsook Egypt, not fearing the wrath of the king, and endured as seeing him who is invisible. So he had to forsake, and Egypt, Moses did, and these people are going to have to even forsake Jerusalem during that time and flee into the wilderness. And then that last part about he endured as seeing him who is invisible, that is, what did Moses see? He endured. He left Egypt, he went in the wilderness, and he endured as seeing him who is invisible. Well, we know in the sense that he saw God at the burning bush and the promises there, but he saw God in all that was going on in his life, even all the way back to what Moses' parents might have saw. Come back to Acts chapter 7. Moses saw something in faith, and faith is the definition, according to Hebrews 11:1, is faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. It's believing what God had to say rather than what you see happening. Moses saw how God was going to use him. And so when he fled into the wilderness, he had to endure as having seen him. He seen what God was doing in all this, although, boy, it sure doesn't look like God's using Moses. Here he's fleeing out of Egypt, rather being a deliverer of his people from Egypt. But in Acts chapter 7, verse 22, it says, and Moses was learned in all the wisdom of the Egyptians, and was mighty in words and in deeds, and when he was a full 40 years old, it came into his heart to visit his brethren, the children of Israel. And seeing one of them suffering wrong, he defended him, and avenged him that was oppressed, and smote the Egyptian. For he supposed his brethren would have understood how that God by his hand would deliver them, but they understood not. And the next day he showed himself unto them, and And the next day he showed himself unto them as they strove, and would have set them at one again, saying, "Sir, ye are brethren. Why do ye wrong one another?" But he that did his neighbor wrong thrust him away, saying, "Who made thee a ruler and a judge over us? Wilt thou kill me as thou didst the Egyptian yesterday?" Then Moses fled at this saying, and was a stranger in a land of Midian, where he begot two sons. So Moses, when he defended his own people against an Egyptian, he thought his people would realize that the position that he has growing up in the palace with Pharaoh, as almost a son to Pharaoh, that they would have realized that God was going to use him to deliver them out of Egypt. And when he started taking the steps of doing that, they rejected him. And it was one of them that was going to make it known that he killed an Egyptian, which was going to get him in a whole lot of trouble and caused him to have to flee Egypt. So think of that when you read this verse in Hebrews chapter 11, in verse 27, by faith he forsook Egypt, not fearing the wrath of the king, for he endured as seeing him who is invisible. The deliverance isn't going to come for the nation of Israel right then. He realized God was going to use him. He had to flee into the wilderness, and he endured that time. And it was after that that he came back and did deliver the nation of Israel from bondage in Egypt. So he saw God in it. That's seeing him who is invisible. It says in verse 28, through faith, he kept the Passover and the sprinkling of blood, lest he that destroyed the firstborn should touch them. The whole deliverance from Egypt had to do with taking a lamb and killing the lamb and putting the blood upon the doorpost of your house. And God warned that anyone who didn't do that, that the firstborn in that family would die. And of course the Egyptians didn't do it, and Pharaoh himself didn't do it. But the nation of Israel did it, and they did it by faith. And they feared God in it rather than Pharaoh and all of that. And as a result of that, God did not destroy them, but he did destroy those who did not apply the blood. The people are going to go through this time period, and there's going to be a man trying to control them, but they're going to have to realize that there's some blood to apply to their life, or they're going to be destroyed of the destroyer, the Lord Jesus Christ, who's coming back to judge. And they need to fear him and by faith apply that blood, his blood, to them as the hope of their salvation. It says in verse 29, by faith they passed through the Red Sea as by dry land, which the Egyptians are saying to do, were drowned. And so they kept the Passover, and God delivered them out of Egypt and delivered them into the wilderness. And then they passed from Egypt through that Red Sea unto Moses, as it tells us, in the cloud and in the sea. They passed on dry land, and now that Red Sea and the drowning of the Egyptians totally separated them from that destruction, from Egypt, and belonging unto the Lord. The Lord Jesus Christ is going to come back and deliver the nation of Israel into their kingdom. And they're going to pass from this time into that kingdom by waiting and looking to the Lord Jesus Christ. And so we see these, I number eight of them there, types of Moses' faith that these same people here are going to need in order to enter into the kingdom by Jesus Christ. You'll notice that you got in verse 29, by faith they passed through the Red Sea. Then look at verse 30. It says, by faith the walls of Jericho fell down after they were compassed about 7 days. How much time passed between verse 29 and verse 30? No. They passed, they went through the Red Sea, and then the next thing you find out, it's by faith the walls of Jericho fell down. 40 years they wandered in the wilderness. We've already read in the book of Hebrews here how in those 40 years that those first people that came out ended up dying in the wilderness because of lack of faith, not believing God and his provisions for them, and when it came time to enter the land, they wouldn't do it. Because of unbelief. The next generation rose up, and then God took them, and through Joshua, they entered into that promised land. It's interesting just to see how that God talks about the faith that Moses had and those who followed, but he just jumps over those 40 years. The illustration here is that God sees faith. He don't see the faithless. They're going to die in their unbelief. But his eyes are upon the believing remnant of Israel. He's looking at faith. And he just jumps right across 40 years of time to talk about the next step of faith of the nation of Israel. He only sees the faith. The unbelievers are lost. And it says, by faith, the walls of Jericho fell down after they were compassed about 7 days. And Jericho is the place where they began to enter in and to conquer the land. And when God brought them across the Jordan River to the promised land, the first city is Jericho, but rather than them running and fighting for that right to be in that land against the people of Jericho, God just told them, well, every day for 7 days, just walk around the city one time. Then on the seventh day, they walked around the city 7 times, and on the seventh time, they were to shout and scream. And when they did, the walls of Jericho fell down, and they fell down outwardly. You can read about it because they found the city of Jericho, and the walls are just like God said. Usually if an enemy goes conquer that city, they'll tear down the wall. Well, you batter the wall down, it'll fall in, and then you conquer the city. But the excavation of that city of Jericho demonstrates that the walls didn't fall outward or inwardly. They fell outwardly. God tore down their defense, and they ran and fled, and the nation of Israel conquered Jericho because of the hand of God. God demonstrating to them how they were just to believe Him, and He would bring them the victory. And so they walked around. It says that the walls of Jericho fell down after they were compassed about 7 days. Doesn't that remind you of something that we're studying? How long is the wrath going to fall? 7 years. You be faithful for 7 years, and God will bring the victory. And so we see the faith not only of Israel past, but the faith that the nation of Israel will need in the future. Then in verse 31 it says, by faith the harlot Rahab perished not with them that believed not, when she had received the spies with peace. And what that is before they entered into that land, they sent spies in to spy out the land, and they were caught, and they were fleeing from those who were chasing them, and Rahab took them in, hid them in her house, and then when they came to find them, she sent the people that were looking for them off in the wrong direction, let the spies down, and the promise is that since she helped the nation of Israel, is that when Israel goes and conquers the land, that if she would put a scarlet cord down from her window, everybody in her house would be safe. They would not destroy her and her household, and that she would be saved as they come and conquer the land. And so there's a reminder here of how a Gentile is going to be saved in that kingdom. Not only is Jesus Christ going to come back and save the nation of Israel, but the nation of Israel is going to spend some time fleeing and needing some protection. And as you read Matthew chapter 25, when you read those verses that say, I was hungry and you fed me, and I was thirsty and you gave me drink, and I was naked and you clothed me, I was in prison and you visited me, that's Jesus Christ judging the Gentile nations. And they're going to say, well, when did we do that? And He said, when you did it to these, my brethren, the Hebrew people, you did it unto me. And they're allowed to come enter into the kingdom that was prepared for them from the foundation of the world. The Gentile nations that did not protect the nation of Israel, He said, go away, you cursed, into everlasting punishment that's prepared for the devil and his angels. The way the Gentiles are going to be blessed, according to the Jewish program, is on how they dealt with the nation of Israel. And if you look at verse 30, you're reminded of that you're dealing with Rahab, and she is unclean, because it calls her Rahab the harlot. The harlot Rahab, as it says here. It's talking about an unclean Gentile who found safety, who found salvation in the nation of Israel by choosing to side with Israel and the God of Israel against her own people and against her own gods, and against her own nation for the sake of Israel. And as a result of that, she is saved, as it says, by faith, the harlot Rahab perished not with them that believed not, but had received the spies with peace. And so that's the reason that she is saved and was preserved in Israel's kingdom when they established the kingdom. So you have a testimony of what faith has done all the way through here. Now, when you get to verse 32, we get to that point where the writer has been writing many things, and he gets to the point where he says in verse 32, it says, and what shall I say, what shall I more say, for time would fail me to tell of, and he starts listing several people real fast. Well, you get to the point here where you realize, well, the writer, he's been really going through detail, giving us some people. But in everything that he has written, he's writing to encourage the Jews about their faith and the importance of faith, the fact that they are to believe what God has said, that they are to rely on the truth of God's word even more than their own senses or peers. And both of those are all the way through here. It's not just how things are look with the eye, and it's not just what the pressure other people can put on you. It's you need to believe what God has to say and their salvation in that. And so the writer has been writing about these great men of the faith to encourage the nation of Israel to that kind of faith. But in all the examples that he has given us, I think he's gone through 11 different people at this point. some 18 different incidences in people's lives to give them illustrations of that type of faith of the nation of Israel, but he's only covered 6 books of the Old Testament. Out of all the illustrations, you start all the way back there in verse 4, by faith Abel, you're in the book of Genesis. All the way down, you're in the book of Genesis. When you finally get to Moses in verse 23, you finally get into the book of Exodus. And then when you get them going through, well, they went through verse 29 into the wilderness, that would take you through Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy. When you get into verse 30 and 31, you finally got into the book of Joshua. So you just covered 6 books of the Old Testament and several examples of what faith is. And so you realize if he keeps at that pace, the Bible's going to be twice as thick as it is. And so what he begins to do here is he quickly lists 6 more people just by name. And then he starts giving some what faith has accomplished in their life. If you look at verse 32, it says, "And what shall I say more? For time would fail me to tell of Gideon and of Barak and of Samson and of Jephthah and of David and of Samuel and of the prophets." Now, if you think about the names that he's given there, he starts out in the book of Judges with Gideon and Barak and Samson and Jephthah. You get into the kings and so on with David and even the Samuel. And then he says, and the prophets. Well, Isaiah all the way to Malachi. He has now taken you through the whole Testament in that one verse from the book of Joshua, or the book of Judges, which follows the book of Joshua, all the way to Malachi, just in a real quick statement of some people. And he just, when he gets to the prophets, rather than naming any prophet, he just says the prophets, and that carries you all the way through. Then he begins to list the things that they accomplished. So let's go and start looking at this and realize there's a pattern here. And not only keep this part in mind, and I think I might have illustrated that enough where I can take this down, and you'll see a pattern of what he is going to be expressing. I should have checked my spelling. I'm going to get in trouble here. and see that in the things that are going to follow here, he's quickly going to go through some things, but there's a way to categorize the things that he's going to say. First of all, he mentions the people that he just did. And I would challenge you sometime, and this was a help for me, that when I read the book of Hebrews, I went back because the book of Judges was always a strange book to me. When I looked at Gideon, sometimes I didn't look and see the faith that God saw, because I saw men's weaknesses. And it's a testimony when you go through these men that are picked out here. I mean, even a man like Samson that you know something about and how Delilah tricked him several different times. And even the fact that he's messing around with Delilah is a bad testimony in the first place. And you realize that what God is seeing here, there are failures in all of our lives. But God, through the cross of Christ, can look and see faith and honor that faith. And in our sins is what the book of Psalms says. He removes our sins as far as the east is from the west. God don't even see it. And here he takes men and he pulls out the times they did step out by faith and honor him and please him in faith. And that's what he sees. And I thank the Lord, as I look at my life, that, you know, that God is someday going to take all the failures, well, he already has by the cross of Christ, takes all my failures, and he doesn't look on them. He doesn't, they're removed, he don't even see them. And then someday when I stand at the judgment seat of Christ, whatever his word has worked into my life, and I've responded by faith, he puts me down as a hero of faith. He's going to reward me. And you think of how little we deserve any rewards. And so when I look at verse 32, that really helped me to look back at those men and see it the way God sees it. He looks at these men and their 6 additional heroes of the faith. And even Jephthah is an interesting one to go look back, and I think it's Judges chapter 11. This guy, well, look at this. Judges chapter 11. His people rejected him because of his upbringing, because of his own birth. And it's a testimony how God uses all who believe on him. I hope I'm right. Judges chapter 11. Judges chapter 11, it says, you knew right away Judges was the 7th book of the Old Testament, right? Because we just did all that talking like that. Judges chapter 11, verse 1, it says, "Now Jephthah, the Gileadite, was a mighty man of valor and was the son of a harlot. And Gilead begot Jephthah. And Gilead's wife bare him sons, and his wife's sons grew up, and they thrust out Jephthah, and said unto him, thou shalt not inherit, in our father's house, for thou art the son of a strange woman. And they threw him out. Well, apparently his dad had an affair with a Gentile woman. That's one of his sons, but he has other sons with a woman in Israel. They took this son, born of a harlot, and said, get out of here, you have no part of our family. Well, when you read down, you find the people of Ammon, the Ammonites, began to persecute Israel. They needed a leader. This guy was a valiant fighter. They went and begged him to come back, and he said, well, I thought you didn't want me. And they said, well, you come back, and we'll make you our leader. And he comes back, and he asks God for help, and he defeats them, and they make him leader in Israel. So God takes someone that the world has rejected and just threw away as nothing, that he's a person who asked God's help, and by faith he conquered and delivered the nation of Israel from the Ammonites, and he gets written down in the book of Hebrews in God's Hallmark Hall of Faith. So Jephthah, a person of national ill repute, is not looked that way by God. He's looked at someone who believed him, and it's written down. And the writer of Hebrews, you know, starts naming these names and what he could. Time fails him to tell of Gideon. I'm back in Hebrews 11 now. Gideon and of Barak and of Samson, of Jephthah, of David, also, and Samuel and the prophets. So it names these men of faith. So these heroes of faith are men of the Old Testament who believed God. Now that's important to know. There's people there. But after that, in verse 33, you begin to see what kind of things they accomplished. Now I looked at verse 33, there's six things, and there's six people up in verse 32, but I don't know that they relate. In fact, as I look at them, I'm thinking that when he says the prophets, that mostly the things in verse 33 were done by the prophets. But verse 33 said, who through faith subdued kingdoms. Now they did some of that. Wrought righteousness, obtained promises. But when I read, stop the mouth of lions, who do you think of? Daniel. You almost had me agreeing with you. That's like the trick question. How many pairs of animals did Moses bring into the ark? Oh, that's right. Okay. Daniel, stop the mouth of lions. Verse 34, it says, quenched the violence of fire. Escape the edge of the sword. So it names the six different things that faith enabled them to do. And I, again, just listing them, subdue kingdoms, wrought righteousness, obtain promises, stop the mouth of lions, quench the violence of fire, and escape the edge of the sword. So not only are there people of faith, but that faith had some accomplishment in their life. And then faith more than just accomplished things in their life, it worked internally. It empowered them. As you get down into verse 34, you begin to see how faith works in different ways. In the middle of verse 34, it says, out of weakness, we're made strong. Now remember, all this is the result of faith. Out of weakness, we're made strong. It says, waxed valiant in fight. Turn the flight of armies of the aliens. Women receive their dead, raised to life again. So, the empowerment of faith to take their weaknesses, and you do see weaknesses. You see it in Gideon and some of these other men. You see some of their weaknesses, but faith took their weaknesses and made it strong. And then that term, waxed valiant in fight. What a testimony of a person living and fighting the good fight of faith. You know what we're talking about on Sunday? Calling on us and realizing how Paul uses military terms about our Christian service for the Lord. That we need by faith to be empowered to wax valiant and fight. To turn the flight of armies. To actually just take a whole army, turn them around and chase them out of town. And they did that by faith. And then by faith, women received their dead to life. Anybody know how that took place? Yeah. Elijah, a widow woman who was Elijah or Elisha? Elisha, I think. where the woman's son died, and she calls for him. He comes back, and he prays, and she received her son back. And so faith empowered these things to happen. They surely didn't happen by man's own strength. And by faith, they accomplished these things. They were empowered to do these things. Now, there's a change that's going to take place in verse 35 because, boy, if faith was just that way, where we could be a people who believe God and through faith accomplish great things and by faith be empowered to have such wonderful victory in the world. But faith gives you victory in the unseen world, too. And the unseen world is, in our chart, it's the world to come, is it not? Is it not in resurrection? By keeping our focus on not just the world right now, but on the world to come. That faith then can work in those means. And you'll see faith's enablement in these next things that are listed beginning in verse 35. It says, in verse 35, it says, and others. So it named all the great victory that people have done. But listen to what others have gone through. And others were tortured, not accepting deliverance, that they may obtain a better resurrection. That these people chose to go ahead and be tortured. They didn't get the deliverance. They didn't choose the deliverance. Maybe it was offered, denounce Christ and we'll set you free. And they didn't choose to go through that, that they might obtain a better resurrection. And hopefully a verse like that, you realize that there is, in resurrection, a weight of glory. There is going to be rewards for the things that we've gone through, and as we studied on Tuesday and talked about, that the sufferings of this world are not worthy to be compared to the glory that shall be revealed in us. That the things that we go through in life, the Bible says that our sufferings work for us a far more exceeding and eternal weight of glory, why we look not on the things that are seen, but on the things that are not seen. For the things that are seen are temporal, but the things that are not seen, they're eternal. And so if you can set your mind by faith to the things that God has promised, and with that goal in mind, go through and not accept the deliverance, the Bible says, if we suffer, we shall reign with Him. If we deny Him, just to get out of suffering, He'll deny us. And that is that reigning position, the weight of glory. And so some people, while other people did great things in this world through faith, some people looking to the world to come, the unseen world, accomplished great things as they were empowered by faith. Again, verse 35 says, and others tortured, not accepting deliverance, that they may obtain a better resurrection. And others had trials of cruel mockings. Some of the things that were done, and you probably have heard of how they would have an arena. I mean, even Daniel being thrown in the lion's den. Some of that stuff was all done just to entertain the heathens who captured Israel and would just entertain themselves with their death, whether it be thrown to animals or whatever it might be. Others had a trial of cruel mockings and scourgings, so they beat them. Yea, moreover, of bonds and imprisonment. They were stoned, and they were sawn asunder, were tempted, were slain with the sword. And so it names all the kind of tortures that they went through. All these things are listed, and by faith, they were enabled to go through those things. So faith isn't just external victory. Sometimes faith is dying in some real terrible forms, and yet the way they were enabled to do that because of their faith. God working in them and faith giving them that kind of power to go through such sufferings. And then there's also, beginning in verse 37 or middle of verse 37, is what I call faith's endurance. And another thought about that is when you read here, you'll see how impoverished they were. It says in verse 37, now, in the middle of the verse, it says, they wandered about in sheepskins and goatskins. I guess I used to think about that as if they would sew them up in these things and let animals eat them. I've heard of this kind of suffering that some people had. But it's not saying that they were sewn in these things. It says they wandered about in sheepskin and goatskins as if they didn't have linen to clothe themselves with or clothing themselves with animal skin. It says being destitute, afflicted, tormented. So these people learned how to endure some suffering, to in poverty, destitute. It says in verse 38, a parenthesis, as he's gone through so many things, that if you just stop and think of the things that people have suffered in faith for the Lord. And by the way, this is Old Testament saints have done this up to the time of New Testament time. But you know, when the Bible ended, the church went through years and years of what we call the Dark Ages. And these same type of things occurred over again to believers of the body of Christ who would stand for the grace of God and believe that they had a right to believe the Bible without the dictations of a church. And people died all these same cruel mockings that are listed here, that the church has gone through these things. Verse 38 stands and says in that parentheses there, of whom the world was not worthy. Now, I thought about that because it's not just the writer of Hebrew who says the world wasn't worthy of these men who died in such cruel ways and went through such sufferings. That's inspired by the Spirit of God. It's a fact. Cruel people, the world who was doing these torturous evil deeds against people of God, they're not worthy of these men's sufferings. They're not worthy of this. And you know, that kind of reminds me of God's grace, doesn't it? That's what grace is. Grace is getting what you do not deserve and cannot earn. We don't deserve, not only do we not deserve people who have gone through terrible things in order to maintain and stand for the faith of God. It's as if they're not worthy of it, then God could have rightfully just damned the rest of the world and tortured them and killed them, throw them in the lake of fire. Anytime he had, if they weren't worthy of it, and that's a fact, anytime he could have damned the world and be just in doing so. But he still hasn't done that, has he? God still gives this unworthy world an opportunity still to be saved. That's what grace is about. Grace is getting what you do not deserve and cannot earn. And so they weren't worthy of it, but God gave them the opportunity to see men with faith and hear a testimony of faith, and time went on. And so did their tortures. Verse 38 says, they wandered in deserts and in mountains and in dens of the caves and of the earth. So it named all these things, that all these tortures that they endured, and I listed them there for you. But as I listed them there for you, hopefully you already know where I'm going with this, because this is not just the saints of the Old Testament times. We put up that chart and showed you there's a time of trial that the nation of Israel is facing to go through again. And so there is going to be a future people of faith, heroes of faith, that Jesus Christ, when he returns, is going to save. And they're going to have to go through some things. They're going to have to subdue kingdoms, and they will. They will subdue the kingdom of the Antichrist. Now, they themselves won't conquer the Antichrist, the Lord Jesus Christ will, but they'll stand up against that kingdom, and they'll stand for the truth of God, and that when it's all done, the kingdom of the Antichrist will fall, as Daniel says, and the kingdom of the saints will stand. Jesus Christ will come and establish the kingdom with them. So they will subdue kingdoms and all the rest that's listed here. There's a future generation of the nation of Israel that shall be empowered, and out of weakness, they're going to be made strong. They're going to stand up and against the Antichrist and against that system. And no matter how weak they might be, their faith will empower them. You wonder sometimes how anyone could do it. But faith is what's going to help them to go through that time. They're going to be empowered by their faith. They're going to be, out of weakness, be made strong. They shall by faith be enabled to be tortured. Because the Antichrist, according to the book of Revelation, if you don't receive his mark and you get caught, they're going to cut off your head. And how are people going to have, how are they going to face cruel tortures like that? They're going to go to the guillotine in faith, realizing that in a few short years, Jesus Christ will come back and they'll be raised into that kingdom. And so it's not just the faith of the saints of old, it's teaching the nation of Israel the kind of power that there is in faith. Faith that would subdue the kingdom, empower them, to enable them to go through the sufferings that they have to go through. And by faith, they are going to endure destitute times, are they not? They're going to have to go hide in the dens. They're going to have to hide in the mountains and in the caves waiting for Jesus Christ to come back, because that's what they're told to do when the Antichrist sets up that mark of the beast. And by faith, they will go and they will endure that impoverished time. And when they do that, Jesus Christ will return. You know, back when I said about subdue kingdoms, you realize that when the Lord Jesus Christ was saying to them, if you had the faith of a mustard seed, you could say to this mountain, be removed and cast into the sea, and it would be done. They realize in the Bible that a mountain represents a kingdom. And the nation of Israel is going to have faith of a mustard seed, and they're going to tell the Antichrist kingdom, be thou removed and cast into the sea. And by faith and waiting for Jesus Christ, that mountain is going to be crushed by the stone Jesus Christ, and he's going to establish his kingdom forever. It is faith that they're going to have to do to accomplish those things. Now that, all that is written, now you got to get to these next two verses. Everything that's been said about the faith of the Hebrew people of old is to encourage the Hebrew people in Bible days and after the age of grace for the events that they're going to face. And so watch verse 39 and 40 say that's what it's all about. It says in verse 39, it says, these all, having obtained a good report through faith, received not the promise. Now the implication, if God promised it, does that mean God's not going to give it to them? They just haven't received it yet, right? Why? Well, verse 40. God, having provided some better thing for us, that they without us should not have been made perfect. God's waiting for them. They all waited for God to fulfill the promises made to the nation of Israel, and they haven't received it yet because they're not going to get it without the believing remnant of Israel now present, and a believing people of Israel present going through that tribulation. They'll all inherit the kingdom together when Jesus Christ returns. And so that ties in that everything they learned was to teach these people about faith so that they together, so that these people can be a people of faith like they were, like the Old Testament saints were people of faith, and that together they might receive the promises of the nation of Israel. That also reminds me to tell you, or to have you look at that. In verse 39 it says, these all, having obtained a good report through faith, receive not the promise. God, having provided some better thing for who? Us. That means not only the Old Testament Hebrew saints, but this writer of Hebrews and the present day believing remnant of Israel with the future tribulation believing remnant of Israel are all going to inherit together the promises that God made the nation of Israel. Going back to Abraham, the promise of that land. The promises to David, the promise of that kingdom, that God, he says, God, having promised better things for us, that they without us should not be made perfect. And so there is the writer of Hebrews includes himself in as that group of people that are a believing remnant of the nation of Israel who shall inherit the promises of the nation of Israel. Now all that in talking about Israel, I think I would do you wrong if I didn't just stop and look at these things here and say and remind you that in the Bible there is application for all of our lives in the Bible. That we can study and see doctrinally how it relates to the nation of Israel, but you know, we've learned an awful lot about faith, haven't we? How faith is just taking God at His Word, and that's what God would have us to do as well. And that we need to be a people of faith as well. That we need to be God's heroes of faith. People who, no matter if no one else agrees with us, if God said it, we believe it. And to stand on the truth of God's Word. And as a result of that, there is some accomplishments as well that faith will have. When you think about, not only do we need to be a people of faith, but faith does have accomplishments. Does it have some accomplishments in your life? Have you yet learned to reckon your old man dead indeed unto sin and yourself alive?